The thing out there. Okay, so we're recording. Hi, good morning, everybody. Bob Brockert here. I'll be chairing today. Carrie's absent today. And we will get rolling here. Do we have anybody new to introduce before we start? I don't think we do. Okay. Well, then we have some time for public comment. Do we have any public that would like
Well,
to comment?
I need to take roll, Bob.
Oh, okay. All right. Sorry
Okay.
about that.
That's
I
okay.
skipped the roll call part. So okay, Mindy, you're on. Take roll. I'm
Thank
here.
you. Ada Anderson.
Here.
Andrea Suhaka. Barbara Boyer.
I'm here.
Bob Brocker. Connie Ward.
Morning.
David Pell.
Here.
Don Perez.
I'm here.
Donna Mullins.
Here.
Ed Moss. I think I saw Ed. Come on. Ed Moss. George Teal is here.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Ed Moss is here too. He was on mute.
Okay. I thought I'd seen him pop up. George, I'm sorry, we got George Steele. Greg Kaler.
Here.
Gretchen Lopez.
Good morning.
Jim Dale. Judy Kern.
Here.
Justin Martinez.
Here.
Carrie is out. Lisa Ferre. Paul Hazeman. Perla Geller. Phil Cernanik.
Present.
Sherry Haid Vogel.
Present.
Sharon Tessier. Steve Conklin.
Good morning.
Tom Mahowald. Valerie Robson. I see Valerie. Winshaw.
Here.
All right. And I saw Debbie Haney get on. Do we have any other guests with us today? Okay.
Yes, Allison Cutting with Douglas County.
And
I'm sorry, I
Jennifer,
was looking for my mute.
sorry, and Jennifer D'Ambrosio with Douglas County.
All right. And then there's several DRCOG staff. We're done.
Okay,
Yeah, I
thanks,
don't have you all had the opportunity to meet the new board members, like Justin and Judy and Greg? Have they done formal intros?
No, they haven't.
Could we do that, Bob, just real quick?
first, yeah.
Start, Justin.
Hey, thank you, Jayla. Good morning, everybody. My name's Justin Martinez. I'm a council member here in Thornton. And I'm happy to be on this committee. I actually used to work with Dr. Cog many years ago. So I'm really, really happy to be here.
And his wife used to work for the AAA.
That's right. She used to work for the AAA as a case manager.
Glad to have you, Justin. Judy, do you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, good morning. Sorry, my video is not working this morning. Although maybe I'm glad, I'm not sure it is still morning. But hi, I'm Judy Kern. I'm up a little bit farther north. I'm in Louisville, Boulder County. But being part of the AAA is like really important to me, and I'm so glad to try to help and participate where I can. I think it's one of the things that makes Colorado such a, and the Denver metro region specifically, such an amazing place to be is the kind of work that we do collectively for our seniors. So thank you all for everything that you do. I really appreciate it. And last month was so fun to be in person and participate and celebrate. Bravo, Jayla, and hearing your background in this organization was quite stellar, I have to admit.
Thank you. Been around forever. Greg.
Good morning. This is Greg Kaler. I'm a lifetime Coloradoan, lived in the metro area all my life. So this is really important to me to be able to give back at this stage and help the citizens. I live in Adams County right now, and I'm a part of the Adams County Aging Network, and just want to help out and do what I can to help our senior people. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you, Bob, for letting us do that.
Of course. No problem. Now we can open it up for public comment if there's any public to make any comment. I guess I'm not hearing any. And so the next item on the agenda is the report of the chair, and the chair has nothing to report. So
Bob, somebody did have her hand up. Allison.
Yes. That's all right. I was trying to find the raise hand. I just wanted to make an announcement that Douglas County, we're doing as part of our older adult initiative. We are going back out on the road for our road shows this summer. So we're excited about that. We're going to be in 14 different locations in Douglas County. And this is part of the initiative that started last year. And we're going back out to talk to our residents and find out really what they need to live and age well in Douglas County. So we're excited about that.
Okay. Thank you, Allison. Any other comments? Okay. Hearing none. Then we'll move on to Jayla, and she's going to tell us about her report for this month. So, Jayla.
Right, great. Well, first of all, I want to say thank you for your service to any veterans who are out there. I come from a long line of veterans. My dad, my stepdad, my father-in-law, my grandfathers were all veterans, several family members. I also want to thank any of those who are family members of veterans, because they provide a service as well. It's not easy to have a loved one in the service, especially if they're out of the country. So thank you all, and let's not forget to honor our veterans. You may know that we have a veterans directed program. In the Area Agency on Aging, we serve about 120 veterans, and they are pretty amazing people and have some amazing stories. I wanted to tell you that we recently had our state evaluation from the State Unit on Aging. They came out. It was a site visit this time. Sometimes they're desk audits. This time it was a site visit audit. They went out to several contracted providers, as well as came in and looked at some of our records on particular programs. We don't have the final results yet, but my understanding is that it's gone very well. And thanks to Sharon and Travis and Aaron in particular, and then Mason for holding the fort down while they were out doing site visits. I had the privilege of going to Jefferson County Seniors Heroes event, and our very own Donna Mullins was given tribute there, along with Carrie Johnson, which was really wonderful to see for their years of volunteer service in Jefferson County. What a wonderful event. I had so much fun. That was the highlight of my month, for sure. I don't know if you want to say anything about it, Donna.
Yes, it was just a very joyous, happy day. Lots of balloons, lots of colors, lots of good stories. And I was very honored to be awarded a senior hero award.
It's a big deal in Jefferson County. They don't give that award to just anybody.
Thank you for coming, Jayla. That really meant a lot.
Sure. I also had the opportunity to go to present to folks in Clear Creek County. Shuri Haig Vogel, who is on the advisory committee, is really, I mean, has been excellent in developing some leadership in the county, bringing individuals and service providers together to really talk about what's going on in Clear Creek County and what the needs are. Share the COSOA report with them a couple of days ago and talk about what we found in our survey. And hopefully that'll help inform some future planning. It is, Clear Creek and Gilpin counties have the oldest residents in the region. Jefferson County is the biggest, oldest county, but the folks in Gilpin and Clear Creek are the oldest. And for you men, if you want to live a long life, move to Gilpin or Clear Creek, because they are the longest lived men in the region. So there's a lot of, there's just a little bit of difference. So when you go to, in most places in the region, when you go to a congregate meal site, you see a lot of women. But in Idaho Springs, you see a lot of men getting service. A lot of men get service in Idaho Springs. And then Georgetown is very unique in itself that they have even an older population than Idaho Springs has. So thanks so much, Sherry, for your leadership in that region. It has been a long time since we've had such collaboration there. We are starting to get materials together and talk about our federal advocacy for the reauthorization of the Older Americans Act and for additional funding that goes along with the Older Americans Act new regulations and requirements. The special Senate hearing committee launched the process. There's been a couple of reports in the last week about the Older Americans Act. All the people in aging, like, you know, the U.S. Aging, NACOA, the National Council on Aging, ASA, are acting like it's going to go forward, but it's supposed to be reauthorized in August, but August is a break for the legislators, so I don't think it's going to be reauthorized in August. All the political people, including our lobbyists who are in D.C., are saying it's not going to be reauthorized in this year. So one of the things we're trying to do is strategically plan how to best advocate for the reauthorization and the Older Americans Act just in time, right? We don't want to do it too early because it's also a presidential election year. And so, you know, there's going to be a lot of craziness and a lot of focus on that. So how do we start talking about it, keep it in front of our legislators' eyes, and then we think we're going to schedule a visit out to D.C. once we can figure out the timing to just remind our legislators how important it is. Bill, you have your hand up?
Yes, I do. Jayla, with the organizations interested in the reauthorization of the Older Americans Act, is there any efforts to make it a meatier support for our older Americans than?
Yes, actually, the Senate Special Committee recommended a doubling of the budget. There was debate this week about that. The Dems agreeing to it, but the R's saying we should focus on the partnership aspect and the entrepreneurial aspects of area agencies on aging. So they're saying we want to allow the area agencies on aging to do more partnerships and do kind of the things that we're doing as opposed to raising tax dollars to pay for services. So there's discussion already about the budget. I think we will see some increase. I don't think we will see a doubling of the budget, But it is really important that we start. I mean, we are going to have the same approach that we did in the state with advocacy, having our contractors reach out, developing materials, making sure that we send, you know, stories and pictures of people that get service. We've had the opportunity to meet with a few of our congressional delegation to start talking about the reauthorization of the Older Americans Act. We will continue to do that. So yeah, there is definitely recommended increased funding. I got a call from Denver City Council folks. Several Denver City Council people called a relatively urgent meeting. Olga and Perla were also on the call related to older adults being evicted and who had complained about rent increases in their area. So Volunteers of America has three housing affordable housing units for older adults and veterans in Denver, and they raised their rent significantly, in some cases $200 or more. And it, there are older adults in their late 70s and 80s there that just can't sustain a rent increase like that. So they called kind of an emergency meeting to talk about what could be done. Where were the resources? Was there any emergency funding? And basically we came to the conclusion that there is not many short-term solutions for these folks in Denver, unfortunately, or in the region. Unfortunately, there were some people that thought, oh, well, we can put them in nursing homes or assisted living. And I reminded them that there are functional requirements as well as financial requirements to go into assisted living or a nursing home on Medicaid. All of those folks would qualify financially, but not functionally. So that's not an option for most of the folks that live in that housing. We talked about, you know, the impact of the migrant situation in Denver, making housing that was traditionally more available, temporary housing more available for older adults when this is not there anymore. Resources aren't there to help out older adults from the city. So it was disheartening, sobering, yeah, to realize that there aren't a lot of options for folks that are being impacted. We're going to continue to meet to try and identify those folks that are being evicted and make sure they don't fall through the cracks with the Denver Office on Aging as well as the Area Agency on Aging. That our
Jayla, yes. Judy Kern has her hand up.
Judy. Hey, Judy.
Thank you so much. I wanted a quick question, Jayla. When it comes to the housing for our seniors, you were saying that some of that housing availability is actually being utilized by an increased migrant population. Where exactly is this, like through the Housing Authority in Denver, or who is actually assigning?
This is the City and County of Denver. They have a program to help the migrant population. And so they're providing housing, short-term housing. It's been on the news a lot, as well as, I don't know if there's anyone else from Denver County can talk about it, but short-term housing, monthly stipend, and some healthcare services as well. So that's just really maxed out their budget as well as the capacity in Denver Metro or in the Denver, in Denver County in particular. They bought some hotels, Denver County did, and they have leases with others. So I'm not exactly sure how that, if it goes through the Denver Housing Authority. I don't believe it does, but
they're aware that they're displacing their seniors.
They're not displacing their seniors. They just don't have capacity for seniors when they are displaced.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you.
You know that we're working on our June meeting, which also will be in person. Volunteers of America has agreed to host us. They have a brand new building and kitchen, so we will get to have a tour of the kitchen. We will get to meet some staff. We'll get to see the process of how they put those 4,000 meals on wheels or home delivered meals together. And then they will provide us with a lunch and give us a presentation. So Mindy is working on that with the team from Volunteers of America. I hope it will be something that you can all attend because it's pretty nice new quarters that they have. And I believe that is my report.
All right, Jayla, thank you. Next item on the agenda is our, we need somebody to make a motion to approve the minutes from the last ACA meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a first and a second. And is anybody opposed? No, okay, so approved then.
So that was Judy Kern, and was that you, Steve?
Ed. I think it was Ed Moss.
Ed, oh, okay.
It was Paul Haseman.
Paul.
Oh, hi, Paul. Hi, Paul.
Thank you, Jayla.
Okay. All right, now we have an action item here to recommend approving the allocation of federal and state funds to fiscal year 2025 DRCOG AAA Choice Services Program contractors, which is in attachment B of your.
I can put it on screen here. Hold on just a second.
Okay.
Thank you. I can present on this one. So this item pertains to your approval to continue contracts with these various agencies that are a part of the AAA's Choice Services Program. Oh, first off, I should introduce myself. My name is Sharon Day. I'm AAA Business Operations Manager overseeing contracts and budgeting for the AAA. So this list, the Choice Services program providers. We have, as you see, a number of agencies that we've been working with for a number of years. To back up, the Choice Services program is also referred to as our voucher program. We established it in 2019 for transportation, and then in 2020 for the in-home care services. And under this program, clients contact DRCOG and our staff complete an intake to register them and do the assessment. And then we issue a voucher to that client for the service, and they can choose from among a vetted list of service providers. And those are the ones that you see on your screen. And so those these providers, unlike our grants, are, you know, these are typically fee for service type program service. These are fee for service. We have a negotiated rate with these agencies, and they accept our vouchers, and then they submit an invoice monthly to redeem the voucher and get paid. And we essentially vet these providers to our grantees. We make sure that we look at how long they've been providing the service, their catchment area, if you will, for the service, what area this is that they cover. We look at management and their ability, obviously, to comply with our DRCOG and state procedures. Obviously, they have to have the licensure with in particular with the in-home program, they have to have licensure with the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment. With our transportation providers, these are rideshare companies typically that are registered with the Public Utilities Commission. The on-the-go, I will mention on that list, is actually our new contracted call center. So they are actually going to be contracted to manage, help manage the vouchers for the different providers. They're not a direct provider for transportation, but will be managing the transportation vouchers to some degree with these same providers that are on that transportation list. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have. I see, Phil, that you have your hand up.
Yes, Sharon, thank you. And I appreciate that the group has done a great job of historically vetting the contractors. My question is more not just approving the contractors, but with regard to the voucher budget. You might want to comment a little bit on that voucher budget. And after your comment, I'll make the motion to approve.
Yes, thank you. So the voucher budget is, it's for transportation, it's slightly higher than our current budget. This is the amount that the voucher budget is similar to what we are currently budgeted for this year. It's a slight amount because we are also able to supplement with our FTA 5310 funds. Because of our limited, as you know, with the ARPA money going away, our in-home care budget is significantly reduced. So actually the amount for that proposed budget is less than what we're currently funding for that program. We are serving approximately 200 people under the in-home voucher program currently with the budget that we have now. So we anticipate that we will see a reduction in, obviously, in the number of people served. We are serving over 600 people with the transportation voucher program. So we anticipate hopefully to be able to serve at least that many people with the voucher budget that you would be approving.
And does that answer quick your question, follow up Bill? To that, Sharon?
Sure.
How are the distribution of the vouchers prioritized as far as the recipients?
Yes, we do have a prioritization. And actually, I don't know if folks from that team are available also to help back me up.
Why don't we let's see if Erica's on. Erica?
Yep, I'm here.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. The programs are prioritized slightly differently. So for in-home vouchers, there's a prioritization worksheet for them to go on the wait list because both programs have wait lists. And then based on that prioritization worksheet, they also do an assessment on their activities of daily living, the instrumental activities of daily living, health and home environment. And between all of those assessments for the in-home voucher program, that creates a prioritization because there is a restriction for in-home vouchers on frailty. And so they prioritize those that are more at risk of being frail in their home. And then for transportation, we have a slightly different prioritization worksheet that we work from that is not the same as in-home vouchers. And that one looks at where somebody lives, it looks at their income, and it kind of calculates all kinds of different things based on the Older Americans Act target criteria. And both of these also focus on target criteria. And then that's how we prioritize who moves off of the wait list into the services.
Yep. Thank you, Erica.
Yep.
Andrea's got her hand up.
Yes, Sharon. Andrea.
Just a comment. I have heard a complaint about Carepool not being reliable. And I doubt I could find the email right now, but it did concern me when I saw that. Is there a way for you to follow up? This person sounded like they used Carepool more than once. I don't know if it was the voucher program, but the drivers just did not show up on time. We're not reliable.
Yeah, we are aware of some situations with Carepool, but we just recently brought on MedRide as a new wave provider for transportation. So we are excited to offer individuals options. Again, our program is clients get to choose who they want to provide, and all of the individuals who use Carepool have been offered MedRide as an alternative solution if they need wheelchair accessible transportation.
Yeah. Sharon or Travis, do you want to talk about what you know about Carepool?
Well, I just wanted to add that I know Carepool is on here. They really are a very small part overall of the number of rides, and we are aware that since bringing them on in 2022, they've had challenges trying to with being able to provide the service. So we are watching that closely. Fonda, you might also have something to add about that, because we're not quite sure whether or not we would actually continue that contract going forward.
Yeah. So Sharon, this is Fonda. I can't talk to Carepool. That will be Erica. But I wanted to kind of chime in quickly on the homemaker and personal care. So, and this goes back to Phil's question, we're probably serving almost 270 clients. And even with the reduction, we did not take anybody off of services this year. What we did is we used those prioritization scores that Erica spoke of. And then we also went through their individual assessments of every one of our clients. And then we took a deep dive into what are those ADLs. And so we took even more, we scrutinized that prioritization, the assessments even further, because what we ended up doing is nobody will be without services this year that are currently being served. We did reduce hours. So those who needed the greatest amount of personal care or homemaker, some of those people were not touched. We will continue that same level of care. But those with lower scores, they're still going to be served, but they're going to be served instead of weekly, every other week. But at this point, we've been able to keep everybody intact with services, even going in with the next year, but utilizing those resource tools.
Yeah, and in regards to Carepool, we have about 24 individuals who utilize Carepool right now. Not all of those are wheelchair accessible. We are waiting for MedRide to be approved from the Public Utility Commission to be able to provide ambulatory rides to individuals who reside in our rural areas. But everyone who definitely uses the WAVE vehicles with Carepool have been offered MedRide as an alternative at this point.
And Andrea, to follow up, yes, we will follow up on them.
I'm concerned about approving the contract, which is what we're supposed to do at this point, if there is a problem or if they're too small to serve the people.
We definitely discussed that internally, on whether or not we would move forward. At this point, because we just brought on MedRide, we're hesitant to remove them as a contractor because they do serve a high needs population in the rural areas, specifically Clear Creek. And also we don't have really any other provider that does WAVE outside of RTD and Uber. So
wheelchair accessible.
Yeah. And yes. So we're hesitant to not renew our contract with them until we see how things pan out with MedRide, but we are hopeful about this new contract with MedRide.
Yes.
Okay, I'll go forward.
Is it safe to say then that if we can approve them today and you can cut them off tomorrow if you want to, right? Is it Accurate.
Yeah, that's pretty much what we're saying here, because again, CarePool, one of the reasons we brought them in was for that wheelchair accessible accommodation that they were with their fleet, albeit it was a very small fleet.
Question, Chair. These folks, that these six organizations that are listed here, they all take Medicaid, I assume, correct?
I believe that they do. Erica, maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but that is one of the questions that we ask, but it's not a requirement, obviously.
Fonda, I think only a few of them take Medicaid. Fonda probably knows best.
Yeah, right now, I don't know offhand, Bob, but that is one of the criteria when we are looking at a provider. I'm pretty confident that they all take Medicaid. And the reason being is when we go and vet them is because a lot of times we're transitioning folks onto long-term care Medicaid. And so we don't want folks to have to then find another provider. So a good portion, if not all, but I can most definitely get that to you guys before the end of the meeting. But that's really an important thing for us, because we want them to transition onto Medicaid if they do qualify for long-term care. And that's one of our services that we
I don't think First Light. I don't think First Light takes Medicaid, but I think the rest do.
Okay.
Okay. Any other comments on this topic? And I heard a motion to approve from Phil earlier. Do I hear a second?
Second, Ed Moss.
Okay, thank you. Is anybody opposed to moving forward with this list? No. Okay, so it's approved then. Thank you. Thanks, Sharon.
Thank you.
Erica. Fonda, much appreciated. Okay, so the next item on the agenda is Miles Crane. Miles, are you available to speak? I see you're on here somewhere. You were, anyway. There you are. Hello, Miles. Okay. Well, so our next speaker is delayed. Is that correct?
Yes. Well, not really delayed. They aren't on board until 12:05.
Bob, I can share with you some more information if that's okay.
Jayla can dance.
Of course.
Hey, I hope AJ's on. We have a celebration. Very exciting news. AJ, are you on? Want to share our exciting news?
Yesterday we were notified that we received the grant from the U.S. Aging Center of Excellence for the Community Care Hub that we applied to in early April. And so that will be $450,000 over 2 years, starting on June 1st. To help us develop the infrastructure necessary to partner with healthcare organizations, both in the AAA and in some of our contracted partners.
Can you talk a little bit more about that since we have some time?
Sure, hold on a second. My son is currently watching Bluey because it's the first day of summer. You get away so you don't hear any Australian accents. where to begin? I'm bad enough at public
speaking. Well, one in 20, right, that got this award.
What's that? Yeah, 40. We're one of 20 community-based organizations to receive this award nationally. I think we're the only one in Colorado, and I think we're the only one in Colorado that applied. And basically, the Aging and Disability Business Institute at US Aging received funding from the Administration for Community Living to fund these 20 organizations to develop the model of the Community Care Hub. So we're going to be able to do assessments of our technology and our contractors' technology to see how we can better work together and hopefully get our systems interoperable. We're going to help figure out what level of capacity each of those contractors have and what level of capacity each service has that's relevant and how we can improve that so we can decrease wait lists. And this will be under the auspices of contracting with healthcare organizations, which you'll hear about with Tori Fields later in the agenda. But it'll also have the benefit of streamlining the services of the AAA and our contracted providers under the Older Americans Act services. So it's a great opportunity. It'll also help us continue our contract with Tori Fields Analytics to help contract with even more organizations and build up our staff capacity and our knowledge of how to engage in medical billing and other areas that we will need to formally enter this world.
Yeah, this is a whole new world of medical billing, right? It's not like they give you a chunk of money like they do with Older Americans Act and state funding, say, here's this chunk of money, now provide these services that we tell you to provide. This is a billing program, much like the Veterans Directed program. So thank goodness we have some experience in doing this, because it is a whole different financial model for us. And definitely Sharon's team will be impacted by anything that we do. We have learned some lessons by having a Veterans Directed contract. And hopefully we can use that experience and wisdom in developing what we need to be successful in a Medicare billing environment. Phil had his hand up.
Yes, AJ, you mentioned that this is designed in part to decrease wait lists.
Mm-hmm.
Can you maybe mention what other objectives there might be in taking on this model?
So it is streamlining our operations and making us more efficient, although I don't know how much blood you can get from that stone. We've been operating on razor thin budgets as is. However,
it just brings more money into the pot.
Diversifying our funding so we're not entirely reliant on the federal and state governments. It opens up a lot of opportunities for us. As Jayla always says, there's a few AAAs around the country that didn't notice the budget cuts because the Older Americans Act was such a small part of their overall agency's budget. I'm not sure we'll get there in the coming years, but we'll have the opportunity to keep our destiny in our own hands. The other opportunity it'll open us up for is that I can't say enhanced data because we have pretty good data already, but enhanced data among our contracted partners, where we can hopefully help more people get more services as needed. In partnership with each other, so they could all work on the same client or provide services to the same client in coordination and not in the dark as they do now.
Taking on billing responsibilities, not all the time are bills paid, and Medicare doesn't cover necessarily all of the balance in billing. Will we be taking on any responsibilities with regard to receivables?
Short answer is no, currently, especially now. In the future, I could see us evolving into a place where we take on a little more risk in terms of negotiating contracts where we benefit from our performance. However, no, as it stands right now, the Medicare benefits we're going to be accessing through some of our clinical partners have defined parameters, and we will match them. And since CMS, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, this is a new benefit for them, they've indicated that they're not going to deny claims, but they're going to be monitoring to make sure things go well and to learn from this. So we're designing our contracts to operate within the parameters of those benefits. I'm trying not to sound like a lawyer, and I know I'm failing, but the short answer is no.
Well,
and Phil, we have some experience with this when it comes to veterans, because veterans we have had issues of them denying claims, and so our staff, particularly Mason, is really good at digging through and figuring out and resubmitting. We've had a challenge with veterans recently because the financial service provider that we work with, FMS, they got hacked. And so we have had a delay in getting paid from veterans. We are very fortunate to be in DRCOG, and the past DRCOG has supported us and held us up until we got payment from the Veterans Administration. So the organization is familiar with this, but this is really truly the only way that I believe that we will in the next 10 years be able to serve any more people because keep up with the demand. There is just and the Administration of Community Living, the new regulations actually direct area agencies on aging to do this. So we're ahead of the game.
And I would add, one of the strategies I've pursued, or we've pursued, is we just received this grant, which will pay for our navigator, the navigator salary entirely. So we're not dependent on the reimbursement to make sure this program works at first, which is always the stumbling block. Right out of the gate, you're in debt. And so we don't have to worry about that now. And we can improve our operations and work with our partners to make sure everything's going well before we take the plunge into solely a program run solely on fee-for-service reimbursement.
So one other question about this. So once you get the first payment in June, I guess, will that relieve any other spending that you're currently spending? No, this is all new then, correct? No. Okay.
Ed Haas has his hand up. Yeah.
Hey, does this have any relationship to the community care hub? And when it's appropriate, can you give me an update on that?
Yeah, so this is designed to formalize and streamline the operations of the community care hub under the Area Agency on Aging. So that's all of this that we've been talking about, the billing, the coding, the services, the partnerships with healthcare would operate under the community care hub with the Area Agency on Aging. It's hard to find the border between the AAA and the community care hub right now, and it will remain that way for a while. The benefits,
the AAA has other designations. We're also designated as a aging and disability resource center. We're designated as the veterans directed care organization. So we have different designations, and now we'll also be designated as community care hub.
Okay, any other questions or comments on this topic? Okay, hearing none.
Exciting,
I see Tori down here, so.
We still need to wait for others to join from the C4A.
But Miles is on.
But Miles. Yeah.
Are you here, Miles? Yeah, on but not. Yes. And so, Mindy, you're saying we need to wait a few?
Yeah, if we could wait, you know.
There are other people that are planning to join to hear Tori talk. Anything else? Well, maybe Tori could, before she jumps in, Tori's got a fascinating, oh, Kelly, you could talk.
So I figured with this extra time, it would be a good time to mention to the people on the call that we are planning a virtual meeting on June 18th in the morning to do a legislative wrap-up of the General Assembly this year. We'd also are looking to spend time on debriefing the advocacy effort that was so incredible this year with so many people participating. We want to thank everyone for their efforts to advocate, and we'd like to spend some time on hearing more about the experiences of advocating and any lessons learned, because finally, the third point of the webinar will be to set the stage for the advocacy that Jayla mentioned earlier regarding the reauthorization and additional funding for the Older Americans Act. So you're all going to get an email next week to save the date. We will be inviting all of you ACA members. We'll be inviting the directors from all the AAAs. They were a very strong part of that advocacy effort. Our contractors and some of our community partners. We just really want to take the opportunity to debrief the success that we experienced with such a large advocacy effort.
Donna, what, did you have?
I just wanted to know, did you say what time it was going to be?
So good question, Donna. I always look to you for the specifics. So it will be June 18th, Tuesday from 10 to 11:30 a.m.
Okay, thank you.
So we really did have such a successful effort this year. Kelly, did you want to continue?
Oh, I need to put my hand down.
Okay.
will that webinar be recorded? So if we can't attend, we can watch it after the fact?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay. So I know we had some discussion at one of the last meeting or the meeting before about the bylaws update. Is there anything changed there? Is it still where it was?
It's still where it was. Yes.
Okay. That's all I wanted to know. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. We've got to work with Doug and Jayla and Kelly and Fonda and I will be working on that. We hope to get to it in June or early July, but Doug's been a busy man.
He is.
And on top of that, Jayla, correct me if I'm wrong, but some of the new regulations that are coming down from the federal government could impact the guidelines. So,
yeah, the Older Americans Act definitely changed their requirements for Advisory Committee on Aging. So we want to make sure all that's incorporated. It has been approved. We have not seen, though, how the state is going to direct us, if they're going to add anything else to it or require anything else. So it's now with the state, and the state is developing policies and procedures. So we will be, hopefully we won't have to wait for those policies and procedures all the way, but we are in conversation with the State Union on Aging to talk about that. So we'll be in compliance. I think a big push that I've talked about in the past is that diversity component, really looking at diverse populations and including others like from the business community, from the financial community, and also having a recipient of services. And when techs left, we lost the person that used our services. So we need to look at finding someone else to be a part of our committee. I think we can, if you don't mind, Bob, just to bring on Tori if there's not any other questions, bring on Tori, and I can just talk a little bit about how she came to work with us. And she has such an interesting background. And then she could get started on her formal presentation at the designated time. Is that okay with you?
Of course it is. Let's do that.
Is that okay with you, Tori? She may be doing something else. She is a busy person.
Oh, no. It is okay with me, Jayla. I'm actually just relocating to a better location. But please get started. And then
All right. Can we see you?
Yes. Hold on there? Hold on one moment. It will be 1 minute.
So Tori and I have actually worked together for a while on a national committee, CTAC. This is a committee or an organization that works to help people to help people with advanced illness. A lot of talk about palliative care, about hospice care, about in-home services that allow people to stay and having services. So I've been on this committee for a few years. Tori is a consultant for the committee. And I've worked with her. And then last year, we were at the U.S. Aging Conference, and I got to introduce Tori in a panel session along with the other speakers. And I'm reading Tori's bio as I'm, introducing her, and I'm going, oh my, in my head. Oh my gosh, I had no idea the extent of her experience. A lovely person. Heard her before, but now I'm like, okay. And I said to myself, how I have got to be able to convince her to work with us. Little tiny problem, we have no money in the budget. None. I knew what our budget was going to look like. And so I was embarrassing folks at the conference. I almost got on my knees and begged her. I begged her without getting on my knees. I was trying to figure out anyway. I was even saying, I could throw that into the to be able to work with her. And she was so kind and generous to develop a kind of bare bones budget for us to get us started and help us. So I don't know, Tori, if you want to talk about Phil, you are going to love her because Phil is an actuary. So is Tori.
There are two of us on this phone call. That's very exciting.
Out of the 15,000 in North America, yes.
Wow.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I'm Tori Fields. I am, as Jayla said, I'm a recovering actuary. But I have a master's in public health and a degree in gerontology. And so I'm very passionate about, as Jayla was saying, taking care of people with complex health needs, and especially really solving the longevity challenge. We have more people who are aging than ever before, and that is really, really exciting. It's also a challenge for healthcare and for public health. And so I have spent my time my whole career in healthcare, starting out in quality improvement in healthcare delivery systems. I moved into working in state health departments, especially in taking care of vulnerable populations and older adults during crises. So emergency preparedness operations and disaster response. And then I got the opportunity right after the Affordable Care Act was put into place to move into health insurance and to start to carve in these vulnerable populations into healthcare coverage.
So I started out as an actuary and then moved into value-based contracting and new payment initiatives for insurance companies. I have really only focused on people with complex health needs and have been really excited about the promise and opportunity that the Affordable Care Act has given to us to be able to carve public health into healthcare delivery. And so over the last 5 years or so, I've been building my own company, actually working on payer agnostic models, things that actually support populations at large and provider networks so that they can get better value, they can actually get paid by health insurance companies, and that health insurance companies can understand their worth. As Jayla said, I met her, it must have been 12 years ago now. And I've always wanted to find a way to really work with Jayla. I didn't even know until July of last year where the money for the area agencies on aging came from, and was so surprised by the fact that these services are available to any person over 60. And over the last, how long have we been working together now, Jayla? Almost a year. Over the last 9 months or so, I've been given this opportunity to educate all of my health insurance colleagues on that thing too. Health insurance companies are often looking for these services, but they think they need to find a vendor or somebody that's venture-backed rather than community resources. And so it's really exciting, an exciting opportunity for me and my team to be able to educate folks on what's already available right in front of them, and to also really help think about how we can reduce the wait list time for the services that DRCOG provides. I hope that's the background you were looking for, Jayla.
That is. Thank you so much. And we're like right on time. So I think you can start with your presentation.
Awesome. Awesome. Mindy, if you give me 30 seconds, I can actually switch my Zoom from my phone to my computer and I can share the slides. Does that work?
You're on mute, Mindy.
In the meantime, I will make you a co-host so you can share.
Corey has been traveling the country the last couple weeks. It's with her, she was in Hawaii.
Like having to go to Hawaii for work, that must be really hard.
It is hard when it is difficult when it's only for one day. Yeah. And then you're going from I was going from New Jersey to Hawaii to New York.
Oh.
And so it's only something fun when you actually get to be there. But as Jayla was saying, I actually have been traveling for the past couple of weeks because a lot of what I've been doing over the past 4 years or so has been strategic planning for health departments and helping them identify areas of unmet need. And in the state of Hawaii, only 2 weeks ago, became the first state in the country to receive federal approval for the ability to cover palliative care services as an essential health benefit. And so that actually really helps provide pain and symptom management and alleviate suffering for people with serious illnesses. And it paves a path for other states to be able to do that too as part of their state budget. And so the you guys might have heard of waiver initiatives or a lot of waiver programs that are coming out across state Medicaid agencies. And waivers are just a way to make a pilot, but waivers tend to end. And so I've been working in this area to reduce the number of waivers and to make things more permanent in the budget at the state level. So we're sort of going across the country, adding some things to people's budgets. That's the hope here too. Mindy, would you please add me as a co-host just one more time?
Okay. Sorry, I got to find your name here to do that. All right.
There we go. Thank you very much. So thank you so much for having me today to talk a little bit about what our team is helping to support with DRCOG. A little bit about what my company does. We are a tech-enabled network enablement platform. And that's a fancy way of saying that we help provide support and analytics for value-based agreements or for contracting initiatives between healthcare payers and providers of services. And we are contracted all over the country to develop networks of high quality, high value services, and then to develop out contracting and payment arrangements between the parties. And that is really what we were asked to do here, is to get a better understanding of what DRCOG can provide as an area agency on aging, and to develop the business case for how to get payers to start paying for those services. What we are doing under our contract are four different things. The first is to develop a sustainable pricing model for DRCOG services. The second is to facilitate relationships and to support contracting efforts with local payers. And also to develop a continuum of care of the services that DRCOG provides. We know that we'll probably start with one of those services and to make sure that we can develop out the operational infrastructure and the relationship between DRCOG and the insurance company. But that once you get in the door, you can sell a lot of other things. And so the goal is to help them understand the value of the partnership in addition to the value of the services that are being provided. And as part of that, we're working with DRCOG to develop sales materials and other collateral that can help support these contracting initiatives and really design the business case that can go on some of these presentations. I'm just going to stop and share what is the bigger context here and why is it a really good time to do this now. There are a lot of states, post-pandemic especially, that have found that there are a lot of people in need and a lot of different types of providers who can meet that need. And so I'm just giving a little bit of a flavor of some of the programs that state Medicaid agencies and also private payers have been covering across the country. And these are services that DRCOG already provides. So in terms of thinking about enhanced case management or care coordination that is being performed by nurses and social workers, there are a number of states that have actually started to pay for these enhanced case management services to make sure that people get screened and assessed and followed up on for their needs. And so that is happening in Oregon and California and in Maine through a number of different programs. The one that's getting a lot of attention right now is called CalAIM, and that's in California. And it's a big waiver initiative that is occurring there. The second, which is more of what we'll talk about today, is health-related social needs. And Oregon was actually the first state in the country that was allowed by Medicare to pay for housing as part of their healthcare budget. In Massachusetts, they, after that, were the first state that started to be enabled to pay for food as medicine, so as part of the healthcare budget. So, you know, when we're thinking about diversifying the Older Americans Act revenue, these are places that we can really look and say, oh, wow, health insurance companies and Medicaid managed care are actually starting to pay for these services as part of the healthcare budget. How can we get DRCOG actually cut into some of that budget? In Maine and in California, they have specific dementia and caregiver support programs that they're paying for. And in Kentucky and Virginia, they're actually funding community health worker programs, so community outreach, assistance, and engagement initiatives. And so these are states that actually have gone first to be able to start offsetting the budget that is coming from the federal government. And many of them are using area agencies on aging as part of that strategy, part of that implementation rollout. We're hoping to be able to really get HCPCF in Colorado on board with some of these things and to make sure that DRCOG is really thought of as a leader in being able to deliver these services. What our focus is right now, though, is on private payers. So insurance companies and affordable or accountable care organizations who pay for the cost of healthcare, and for them to understand better the business case for DRCOG. And so our team has been working to identify high yield partnerships, ones that can be ongoing and good partners through a pilot. We also have been working with the team internally on readiness and on calculating the revenue opportunity. And we've been prioritizing insurance company outreach based on their likelihood to implement the fastest. So we want to get a pilot this year to be able to start paying for DRCOG services. We're focusing on diversifying revenue on current programs. So DRCOG already has a lot of services that you provide. You actually don't need to develop new programs in order to get paid for them. You just need to find the right partnerships to start to pay for those services and to reduce the wait list time. And as part of that, DRCOG has been participating in the Health Equity Learning Collaborative. That's that HELC model that you see on the bottom here. And as part of the HELC, there are payment codes for assessments for health-related social needs. And that's really what folks are very interested in right now. They need more people to perform assessments and also to direct people to services to meet unmet social needs. So our focus and our priority here is to start with that health equity lens and health equity model, and then to move into how we might start contracting for things like falls prevention or for dementia and caregiver services, which seem to be things that are of interest to the payers in the state. The activities that we have performed so far are actually going through and assessing DRCOG's workforce and capacity to deliver services. We've also been working on structuring the health equity model that DRCOG has that looks like a care model. And insurance companies need things to look exactly the way they need them to look. So what we're doing is starting to put some language around the services that are being provided so that health plans can think of it as a model that can be priced and can be contracted for. We've also been looking at what the cost is of delivering these services and the capacity that DRCOG can take on. And our team has been actively engaging with health insurance companies to then explain to them what DRCOG is doing and what they're looking for out of a contract. In the next month or so, surprise Jayla, I think you're going to start contracting with some payers. Because we are just-
the next month?
I think contracting can take time. So this will be the start. but we have some payers who are really interested in like actually writing down the details now. We'll start with that last bullet this summer so that hopefully we can get a pilot up and running by the end of the year. News.
Very exciting, but a little scary too.
It is a little scary. However, what I will say is that I've done a lot of workforce assessments on providers across the country. And usually we start with what the goals are, and then we start to look at the infrastructure and staffing and services, and we find that the providers can't actually meet their own goals. And it takes providers a lot of time to develop the right infrastructure in order to get paid by an insurance company. And we have gone through this workforce assessment with DRCOG and have found really that you are well set up to start going through these contracting efforts and to start working with private payers. You already have the infrastructure and the team in place to start getting paid for services by different types of plans. And that's really exciting to me, makes my job really easy because it just allows me to say that you're doing it already. So in terms of thinking about what came out of this assessment, there were three big things to take away. The first is that DRCOG already has a lot of internal and external partnerships that can be used to just get started. So you already have the staffing, you already have trained staff, you have an infrastructure in place to be able to expand your offerings to private payers with minimal effort. So it's not going to cost more money to get started. The second is that DRCOG has really spent a lot of time investing in reporting and data and technology HIPAA compliant platforms. And most providers, even in healthcare, are not set up to collect the data that payers need in order to pay them differently. And DRCOG is already set up to report the right things, to share information and share data with health plans and health systems. And you're in a really attractive position, especially, you know, and in light of that Change Healthcare thing, to be a trusted, compliant entity with health insurance companies. And that is going to make it so much faster to get going. In addition, you already have a lot of programs and services that are already in place and are really strong, as evidenced by the tremendous amount of wait list that you have for your services. DRCOG also already has a pretty nimble mechanism to contract with new providers who are delivering a lot of different services. And so you're in a great position to just contract for current services rather than needing to make new programs in order to attract a payer. And that allows you to get going with the staff you have today rather than the need to hire a new workforce and train a new workforce in order to get paid differently. So what we have put forward in terms of our recommendations is to start where you are, to start by focusing on the over 60 population who are covered by Medicare Advantage or by a special needs plan that focuses on dually eligible populations, Medicare accountable care organizations, et cetera, in your service area that take care of the population that you already take care of, and to focus on health plan contracting that is related to the services that you already provide today. So it sounds too easy, but the outcomes that the health plans are really looking for today are things that you can achieve with the programs and the staff and the services you're already delivering to the population that you're delivering it to. And so as part of this business case, what we're bringing out to payers is that DRCOG is in a unique position to improve quality scores for a health plan, to increase program engagement and utilization of services that the health plans really want increased, and to address and coordinate care for older adults and their caregivers, which overall reduces healthcare burden and healthcare costs. Health plans are also expected and required to distribute some of their dollars to community benefit. And because DRCOG is set up as a community-based organization, that actually counts as distributing funding for community benefits. And so I was just on a call this morning with a health plan, and what they shared with me was that was really attractive to them to be able to add DRCOG to some of their supplemental benefits for Medicare Advantage so that they can also demonstrate that they're partnering with the community. So what does this look like in the service area? What you see here on this map are all of the DRCOG locations, as well as the DRCOG care network locations. So that's what's in green and blue. And the map actually demonstrates the counties by the number of Medicare and Medicare Advantage enrollees in that county. The dark blue demonstrates where you have the most Medicare and Medicare Advantage lives in the state. And that really does overlap with the DRCOG provider network locations and your extended care network locations. So the opportunity here is to be able to start in the Denver metro area and then to expand services out through your care network locations across the state, and to give this opportunity of payer contracting perhaps to other area agencies on aging that Jayla and team have partnerships with. We are getting a lot of interest already in folks being able to get coverage or get these services expanded to El Paso County, so Colorado Springs area, and then a little bit further east of Denver, in that Clear Creek, Gilpin area. So I think as you're starting to see, healthcare payers are really looking to partner on meeting some of these needs, especially these health-related social needs in the areas where you have some darker blue, where they have a lot of people. AJ.
Thanks. I just want to reiterate what you said, Tori, that we're going to partner with other AAAs if we move across the state. We're not going to be doing those, doing direct service in those other regions, but with in partnership and for the benefit of other area agencies on aging. Sorry to interrupt.
No, don't worry. I think it's actually a really great opportunity to expand this to other AAAs, which is really the goal. Because not all AAAs have the infrastructure that Dr. Cog has, but they definitely have the services available. This map demonstrates the Medicare Advantage Plan enrollment and penetration by county. And so what you see in the blue is Centene. Those are the folks who that's the health plan that actually is coming into the state to cover Medicaid and Medicare Advantage beneficiaries. The ones in green is Humana, and the one in yellow is United Health Group. And then the red ones on the right-hand side are Aetna, CVS. And these are just the top Medicare Advantage plans by county. And so what we're actually doing is looking at where there are the health plans that have the most Medicare Advantage beneficiaries, and how does that match up with Dr. Cog locations? And then really looking at the other health plans that may not be the top Medicare Advantage plan by enrollment, but have a lot of interest in addressing these unmet needs. So I'll just note that while United Health Group is in yellow, and it is the top Medicare Advantage plan in the Denver metro region, we're actually really looking to partner with somebody who might go a little bit faster than United Health Group, like Humana or like Kaiser. If you're looking at the locations that are specific to health-related social needs, which would include food insecurity and transportation services, these are the dots in the Denver metro region that actually provide these services. And the darker regions, Arapahoe and Jefferson, and parts of the Denver County area, are the areas that have the most Medicare Advantage beneficiaries. And so there's a lot of overlap between where Dr. Cog provides these services and where there's a lot of need in the private payer market. And so there's a real opportunity to be able to just deliver food and transportation services as part of the Medicare Advantage program benefits that these health plans offer. In terms of thinking about revenue, some of these payment amounts have changed, but what we're looking at is actually a couple of different things. The first is to really get Dr. Cog set up to start being able to bill for the assessments that they're performing related to health-related social needs. And so you'll see those CPT codes on the left-hand side in the table. And the CHI stands for Community Health Integration. And that's the code that has been offered as part of the Health Equity Learning Collaborative that would pay for the assessment for services and for the screenings for these services. It wouldn't necessarily pay for the services themselves. So the pilot that we're talking about is really starting with a payer to get that payer to pay for assessments, And then to see if we can push the envelope a little and ask the payer to offset some of the costs of the services that DRCOG provides. And the hope is that these payers will see such a benefit in the services that DRCOG provides that they'll actually be able to start paying for food and transportation and utility assistance and things like that, instead of finding their own vendor. We have done some initial calculations related to the payers in the market and have found that DRCOG should be able to be profitable in providing these services within 15 to 18 months of when they're delivering care to these patients, and so or these members. And so that's something where it really is dependent on how many people start to get screened, how many people actually access services in order to make sure that we're sort of meeting the revenue needs for DRCOG as you're diversifying. The next steps for this pilot, as I was sharing, is as we're reaching out to initial health plans and accountable care organizations, we are finalizing the cost and the financial model to support the design of this contract. And we've started having some conversations with network providers to think about, you know, what would be the timeline if you were to need to go statewide, or if a payer was interested in expanding services on a timeline. We have worked on finalizing an approach for this screening and follow-up program. We would call that case management, because that's what payers like to hear. And that would really be leveraging those assessment codes and screening codes to be able to direct people to health-related social services. As I shared, we've been reaching out to health plan leadership over the past couple of months for pilot collaboration. And it looks now like we've got a couple who are very interested and one that is most interested. And so the hope is that we can start to bring out and have these conversations about the details, about how we would set up a contract, how we would develop a workflow, and how the clinical case management teams at the health insurance company would actually partner with DRCOG to make referrals and get the reporting that they would need. So those are really the next steps for this pilot, with the goal of having a pilot for about a year, and then having a real conversation about how DRCOG gets paid for the services that you're delivering. I think that's all here. Super happy to open it up and answer questions.
So, Corey, we have.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, we had a couple questions about access to this presentation, being able to share that. Is that okay?
Absolutely. I sent it along to Mindy already, and so she can distribute out.
Okay. And thank you for that. And it was a great, great presentation. Really enjoyed it. And it's extremely informative. So thank you. I had a couple other questions, but I'll let other people go next first here. So, Donna?
I think I'm confused about something, because healthcare advantages, people who have healthcare advantage plans aren't necessarily the clientele we've been working with. We've been working with low-income people. So how do the two, are we giving one up for the other, or are we combining, or...
No, so remember, we don't serve the Medicaid population. We serve right above the Medicaid population.
Right.
And so it is both of those folks. Medicare Advantage is just another Medicare plan. We've always served folks on Medicare primarily. That's our primary population of service.
But and also to add to that, in terms of Medicare Advantage, it is historically served a lot of people of higher incomes. However, when they first started screening Medicare beneficiaries across the country, they found that similar rates of need exist among Medicare Advantage beneficiaries or recipients as they do with straight Medicare or even Medicaid in some cases. So there is still a need there, but we're not, and to add, we're not switching any population. We're potentially adding to generate more revenue to serve the current population.
Okay. I have another really quick question. You mentioned something about United, who is my carrier. What did you say about United and trying to get them to move faster or switch to somebody else? Or
they're a little bit slower to contract, especially for new programs that they don't own themselves. I think actually there is some interest on the Optum side. So Optum is a provider that is owned by United Healthcare, and they are really interested in these types of services being able to be delivered. And Donna, I actually think just to answer your first question a little bit more, what I've been hearing from the accountable care organizations is that you need to have a solution that, regardless of the insurance type, is able to sort of meet these needs, right? And so the goal here is to see where we can get the private insurers to pay for the services that are being covered for their beneficiaries, rather than relying on the Older Americans Act to cover those services when these payers actually are getting the money from the premiums for these patients. So just because people pay premiums for a Medicare supplement or Medicare Advantage plan doesn't mean that they can afford utilities or nutritious food, or even the transportation to their healthcare provider. And so this is really an opportunity to say, hey, there are more and more people on Medicare Advantage. You need to start paying for this in the same way that the Older Americans Act is paying for people overall.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Bill, you had a question?
Yes. Thank you, Tori. And I'm going to ask AJ to help me out here. AJ, we were on the Citizens Advisory Committee for the HTP evaluation. And so the hospitals are receiving money that many of them are not providing improvements to community health directly. And I'm wondering whether the hospitals can also be payers through the HTP program in taking a look at programs that we already know do improve community health.
They could be. And we tried for a long time to tap into that, let's call it a market. But all I kept getting in response from these, organizations with budgets that have three or four commas, is that they can't afford it, and they would like to partner with us, but for free. And so that's why we pivoted to working with Tori and engaging with healthcare payers who are more aligned to working to lowering healthcare costs by addressing these needs. And the federal government was in the same spirit, and it's kind of converged to help us out. But in terms of Medicaid, we do have a longer term Medicaid strategy that'll start sometime next year when the state makes a few more decisions about the 1115 waiver. However, we're going to be careful. They've been an inconsistent partner, and so we're going to be a little more careful as to how we engage with them.
Well, the thought that I'd have is we can start putting pressure on HTP and that transfer to hospitals, that that money actually does need to be used to improving community health. And maybe with some of Tori's assistance, we can get the hospitals off their...
I think Tori agrees with you.
I think to your point, Phil and AJ, there's an alignment that needs to happen. And what I have often seen is that the payer needs to demonstrate their interest, like the health insurance company needs to demonstrate their interest in order for a hospital to really move in that direction, and that it can be a both and, where the hospital or health system is taking on the risk for the cost of care or care delivery. And if part of this is really getting, you know, getting one of the dominoes to fall, so that then we can start engaging other people in the market or re-engaging other people in the market. And so the health systems that have an accountable care organization relationship with an insurance company then are going to be the ones who, you know, Dr. Cog will really be able to partner with to get the volume, you know, to get the utilization for these services. You just sometimes need a little bit of pressure from the insurance company.
I think what we have in Colorado is the HTP program is somewhat a gift or a bribe that is being paid to the hospitals for their abdication around the state's reinsurance program around healthcare. And that money at this point in time, in my humble opinion, is taxpayer wasted money. So love to have your assistance.
Oh, I like strong arming hospitals into things they should be doing.
So Tori, a question on a couple of questions. One on the PACE program. So will this program supplement the PACE program or compete with the PACE program?
Well, a PACE is an insurance company. And so this would be a supplement to PACE, where Dr. Cog could be a partner to these PACE programs to deliver the services that they would need. So in terms of being a program all-inclusive for the elderly, they do take on the risk of managing services that people who are covered by PACE need. And it would be an opportunity for the PACE programs to not have to build all of that infrastructure themselves, but to partner with Dr. Cog to actually expand those services and be a bit more nimble.
Okay.
We're seeing that in California, especially where these PACE programs partner with area agencies to deliver some of these services.
It's good to know. Thank you. Another question on the payer side of this. So you mentioned earlier that they're collecting the premiums, but not providing all the services that they could under the current regulations. So what's in it for them?
What's in it for the payers?
Yes.
Well, I'll start with cost savings, because isn't that what actuaries are known for? The real importance of these services that I have seen in doing my own ROI analyses and partnering with area agencies on aging from the health plan that I worked at, is that if you are offering people diet-specific, nutritious meals, they are more adherent to their treatment plans. They don't go to the emergency department as often, and they actually don't have long facility stays. They recover faster and for shorter periods of time. And if you also think about something like transportation, we want people to be adherent, right? We call people who are not adherent non-compliant, but oftentimes people are compliant. They just don't have access to the things they need. And so what health insurance companies are looking for is someone who's reliable, who's able to go to their outpatient services, who's able to pick up their medications on time, et cetera, and who stays out of the hospital. And so, you know, staying out of the hospital once saves you $21,000. And staying out of the hospital twice is a multiplier, right? And so that's one piece. I think the other piece to call out is quality. Medicare Advantage organizations are now subject to the Medicare Star Ratings program, which is a quality program. And so these health plans get money from the federal government based on how high quality they are. And so if they're able to increase their star rating by even just half a star, they get upwards of $1 billion.
How much?
Yeah, they could get $1 billion, right? Yeah. So you think about it and you say, wow, if we can increase their star ratings, they get a higher rate off that premium and they can actually get paid more on every patient they enroll or on every member they get covered. And so that only expands their market reach, it expands their revenue at the same time as lowering cost. Sort of a win-win here, right? So that's the game we get to play, is to say, you know, how do you increase your quality ratings, which increases revenue for the payer at the same time as keeping people out of the emergency room, out of the hospital, which lowers cost that the payer has to pay.
Excellent, Dave, I
think you had a question during that little speech I gave.
So. I do. What is this? Can you give me an example of how this works from the client's point of view? Just kind of walk me through that a little bit. I mean, the presentation was terrific. How does that work? What does that look like with the new integration from Dr. Kahn?
Yeah, that's great. You'll get me practicing. So I was on the phone with Kaiser this morning and she asked me this question. Exactly. So the health insurance company has a couple of ways of identifying high-risk patients. So sometimes they look at claims and they will identify high-risk patients through claims, but someone has to reach out to them. So either Dr. Cog reaches out to them or a case manager inside of the health plan reaches out to them and asks them if they need something. And that would be then a referral to Dr. Cog, where Dr. Cog would assess these individuals for their health-related social needs using an assessment, you know, screening tool, either over the phone or in home, in person. And then we'd be able to identify based on that assessment what services somebody would need and whether or not the health plan covers those services, at which point Dr. Cog might refer that person to what the health plan is delivering, or Dr. Cog is actually referring to one of their network providers to be able to close those gaps. And so the hope is that there will be more screenings and no wait times for these services, and that more people actually would utilize these services that are available and paid for by the payer.
So it would make it a more efficient way to receive services if they want services, obviously.
Yeah, absolutely. It also would make it really transparent to the health plan about how many of their members actually have these needs.
Gotcha. So it's kind of to be determined whether it's going to be Dr. Cog that's on the front end or if Dr. Cog is going to be step two in that process, whether, is that correct?
I think that's an outstanding question related to what the payers have. What Dr. Cog does have the ability to do is like actually get a list of patients and be able to outreach to them. And so it could happen either way, you know, whether that's the health plan reaching out to the patient and referring to Dr. Cog or Dr. Cog receiving a list and outreaching to these people.
You may remember, Dave, we've already done this, right? We did this in the AHC program, and we're currently doing it with Denver Health. So we're already doing this service. And our goal is to be able to expand it and then to have the health. This is the big one for me, and Tori knows that I say it all the time to her. Pay for the services, right? Because right now we can navigate people right to a waiting list. But we got to get payment for services. But first we have to develop that partnership and show them the value, right?
And Dave, the other thing that's interesting is some of these health plans pay for something like mom's meals, or they pay for Lyft or Uber. They pay for these services, but they're actually suffering because when does a person think their health plan pays for this?
I totally get it. And honestly, Jayla, what I was thinking of was the Denver Health, the way that you're integrated with Denver Health already. And my other concern was, yes, also, sorry, I didn't mean to roll my eyes on that, but navigating somebody to a wait list. And that's the one thing you don't want to do, home delivered meals, for example, and things like that. I mean, this is exciting. And I hate to use the word pivot, but I like the adjustment or looking for a way to do this and move forward and be a bigger part of the community.
What's also really exciting is then when we get payment for services, we contract that out to our local service providers. We pay our local service providers, you know, the VIAs of the world, the aging resources of Douglas County, the Senior Resource Center, right, to provide these services. And we keep that system afloat because their other payment sources are drying up and ours were reduced for them. And we want to keep those community resources going.
Nice. Thank you.
And I would just add, Bob, go ahead.
We have time for like two more questions and then we kind of need to move on. So, I know Tori's a busy person. She probably needs to get going too. So Gretchen, you had your hand up first.
As a former insurance regulator in a different state before I retired, you know, is there a danger that if an insurance company enters into an agreement with DRCOG, that they are going to then, to increase their market share, of course, you know, advertise about these additional benefits, but then pass on the cost to, you know, in the form of premiums and higher premiums to their policyholders?
You know, that's a good question. I haven't seen them increasing premiums. I have seen these health plans adding services into their quality improvement budget. And as part of that, it's like a tactic that these health plans are using to decrease costs, which means that it would need to be budget neutral in the premium. I appreciate your wonkiness. What they do is for some of these payers, they have to pay out a certain amount of dollars in community benefits. And so that community benefit dollar cannot be distributed, like cannot be passed on to the member.
Okay, good. That was kind of a major concern I had. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Judy, you had a question.
Thank you. Just really quickly, I was curious to know, does this, and maybe this is more for Jayla actually, does this allow us to help provide services to a broader group of our seniors, like people who may not be, who are maybe not quite as close to the Medicaid threshold that have, like you were saying, we handle a lot of those, the seniors that are just above that. Does that allow us to include more services for people that may have like a combination of like a teacher's pension and Social Security, so therefore they don't really qualify for a lot of other things normally?
Yeah, absolutely. But the key is we got to get those providers to pay for services, because without that, we can only use the Older Americans Act requirements for services, right? So we would have to, like you were hearing about the prioritization. If the provider doesn't pay for services, then, and they make a referral to us, then they go into the AAA service criteria for service, right? So but if they pay for services, that could open up to a broader population.
Okay, that's what I was curious to know. If you saw, let's say over the course of the next year or two, that you're able to coordinate much more consistent income from the service product, from the insurers, which would actually be a wonderful thing to see, to have yes. that kind of money. Sure, we'll guarantee write you a check for a couple hundred grand. So good. Well, okay, thank you. I really appreciate this work. I just want to give Tori the biggest props I can. This is huge. And I thought I knew a lot of things, and you have shamed me into realizing how uninformed I am. So thank you.
Oh, okay. Well, such a pleasure. Thank you so much. Thanks for having me. Really excited to keep you guys updated on the progress.
Okay. Thanks again, Tori. Much appreciated.
Bye.
Okay. So we're going to move on to the next item on the agenda, which is Miles Crane is going to tell us about the Future of Aging Conference that's being sponsored by the Colorado Commission on Aging. Miles, are you there?
I sure am. Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Volume's working. Thank you, Bob. And like Jayla earlier on in this meeting, I just want to express appreciation to all veterans and their families, especially on this unique weekend that we have. The Colorado Future of Aging Statewide Conference is going to be 2 weeks from yesterday. It's being held at the Embassy Suites Hotel in Loveland, Colorado. The admission is free. Breakfast is free. Lunch is free. Parking is free. And at the end of the day, there's going to be an opportunity to network with people from all over Colorado. The last time they held one of these Future of Aging conferences was about 2 years ago, and that was Colorado Springs. So let's review the program. From 8 to 8:30, it's going to be check-in and a light breakfast. At 8:30, Chad Federich, chairman of the CCOA, and Jody Waterhouse, vice chair. And incidentally, Jody asked me to speak to you today. She's traveling out of town. I'm doing this as a community volunteer and a member of the planning committee. They will make some introductory remarks, followed by Christine Burrows, senior specialist on aging. At 8:50, we're hoping to have a video from the Lieutenant Governor and possibly the Governor himself. At 9:00, Elizabeth Garner, the state demographer, will talk to us about older Coloradans' population outlook and the value they play contributing to the state. Half hour after that, at 9:30, we have Lifelong Colorado. Where are we now? Where are we headed? And that's being presented by Jarrett Hughes, Deputy Director of Policy and Research, Governor's Office. At 10:00, Dr. Marissa Volpe, Associate State Director for Livable and Diverse Communities at ARP, will talk about how does Colorado compare to other states for livable communities. It's really an ARP age-friendly network update. At 10:30, we have two speakers on Alzheimer's disease and related dementia, talking about the state plan, a call to action. At 11:00, there's a refreshment break. 11:20, there will be the Alan Buckingham Awards presented by Erin Fisher, chair of the C4A. She's talking about the Volunteer of the Year Award, presenting it, and the Employee of the Year Award. At 11:35 for 10 minutes more, there'll be a presentation on what we're gonna be doing over lunchtime. I'll get to that in a minute. Lunch, a buffet, will be between 11:45 and 12:15. And then at 12:15 to 1:45, we'll be doing a World Cafe discussion. The topic will be age-friendly communities, building connections across ages. Facilitating this and describing how it'll work earlier on at 11:35 is Rachel Cohen. She's CEO of Aging Dynamics in Denver. And Rachel is also an instructor facilitator at the Changemakers Program, University of Colorado in Denver. We'll be talking specifically about neighborhood and community places. What kinds of structures are in place, buildings, streets, recreation facilities, to encourage people to live in a community, to grow up and grow old. And then there'll be a second discussion during this World Cafe on community programming. Rachel's put together a very interesting handout, filled with photos and descriptions of activities going on all over Colorado. And I'll almost guarantee if you attend this, you're going to learn something about activities elsewhere you've had no idea about and basically how to do them. In the app, we have a refreshment break at 1:45, followed by breakout sessions between 2 o'clock and 3:15. And then the same session repeated 3:20 to 4:35. That's true, the simultaneous sessions for three out of the four tracks, which I'll go over with you right now. The first one is Alzheimer's and related dementia. And the panelists, I won't go over all the names, I'll just do the topics because they're all experts in their field, are Alzheimer's 101 risk factors, risk reduction, warning signs. There'll be another one on cognitive assessments and annual wellness visits. A third presentation on disparities in Alzheimer's disease and related dementia. And a fourth one on Alzheimer's disease and public policy. Simultaneous with that session, which is repeated twice, is one on health and wellness, aging well in Colorado. And there's quite a diversity of presentations here. The first one being mental health and behavioral health in Colorado. How are we supporting our older Coloradans? There'll be another one in addressing food insecurity in rural and underserved communities across Colorado. A third on creative aging to support health and well-being. And a fourth one on financial security and cognitive health, what you need to know. A third breakout track will be on technology-driven innovation and cross-sector collaboration. And here they'll be talking about government investments in digital equity, philanthropy's role, driving innovation, investments in tech and aging. Another one on investments in age tech, the role of the private sector. Then the fourth breakout session is different than the other three because it is not being repeated. It's one continuous session with seven different panelists, four on the first section and three on the second. And they will address workforce opportunities across the state for older Coloradans, specifically contributions to successful future of healthcare research, learn about the older adult research specialist opportunity. Another one on interested in a new job or career shift, check out the Profit from Experience initiative. A third one, innovative intergenerational opportunity to volunteer or be paid, early childhood service corps. Then the Changemakers program. I don't know if you've heard of it or not. Chances are you have. CU Denver. Ann Button is the founding director of this program, which has received national acclaim, whether it's the New York Times or Wall Street Journal, other national media, NPR, CPR. This program to support people 50 and older with life transitions and exploring new chapters has been well received because they compare it with the programs at Harvard University and Stanford at a fraction of the cost. Then we're going to have something on Colorado's innovative focus on the long-term care workforce. And this is the second segment, making the direct care workforce a priority with the Colorado Direct Care Workforce Collaborative, introducing the new Colorado Direct Care Training Curriculum, and then JAWS, directing community partnership to build the long-term care workforce. At 4:45, there'll be a conference review and wrap up final remarks. Essentially, Rachel Cohen, who led the World Cafe discussions, will present action items that we've gleaned from the discussion tables, things that people can take back to them to their respective communities. After that, there'll be a social networking and a cash bar at 5 o'clock. If I didn't say so already, as of yesterday, there were over 220 in-person registrants, over 40 hybrid. And I think that's just about it, other than to let you know that hybrid will probably be mornings only, because it would be very difficult to video what goes on at lunch. It'd be too noisy in the room. And then with four separate tracks, they made a decision not to do that. We are still looking for facilitators at the lunch tables. Very easy to do, just basically encourage each person to speak. But there will be a training program that Rachel's going to give at the end of this month or in early June. If any of you and Dr. Cog are interested in possibly leading a table discussion, I've sent Rachel Cohen's email address to Bob a little bit ago. I also emailed him the most recent flyer with the registration in the event you haven't received it. Hope to see as many of you there as possible. Been an honor to talk to you. Thank you. I'm here for any questions if you have any.
Okay. Thank you very much, Miles. And we look forward to being there. I'm registered. I hope some of you are registered as well. And the registration piece is actually in the handout for this meeting. It's under attachment D. So our next item on the agenda are is the Dr. Cog board report. Dr. Cog board report. Who's giving that today?
So that would normally be me. I did chair this meeting, although I'm no longer a member of the Dr. Cog board because I did not win my election in Lone Tree. So I can give some updates. At our meeting, we had a couple of action items, approval of the fiscal year 2024-2025 budget, and discussion of the FTA Section 5310 fiscal year 24 funding awards. We had informational briefings on the active transportation plan, RTD Fast Tracks annual report, and a wrap-up from the legislative session that was certainly kept us all guessing till the end. I actually wanted to ask if we would, Jayla, if we should ask the group if they would like me to continue as a member at large, since I would no longer represent Dr. Cog on this call.
We can certainly do that, Mindy. You know, it's a good time to do this because we don't have the kind of the bylaws in place, so we have a lot of flexibility right now. Yeah. You know, people say yes. I'm seeing on the yes, Wynn should stay. Ada, I know, wants you to stay. So I think you're a wonderful asset, and having your local government experience is very important. Your board experience is very important. I really see you as someone who could kind of fill the shoes of Kathy Noon, who we had on our committee for 20 some years and was so, so valuable to us in helping us with those kind of policies and procedures that sometimes we struggle with.
Sure.
She's a real winner.
I haven't heard any, no objections. So Wynn, it sounds like all is well.
Great. Would be wonderful to continue to serve. So thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Wynn. Much appreciated. And I'm sorry you didn't win your election, but
there are pros and cons, right? I have two young grandkids who are very happy about it.
I'll provide one more update on the last Dr. Cog meeting. We obviously paid tribute to Wynn and thanked her for her service, and we are very sad, but excited that Wynn will continue here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. Okay, our next item up, our county reports. Does anybody from the counties have a report to make. Starting with Jefferson County.
Well, it sounds like David Pell is not going to say anything, but they had JCCOA attended the Lakewood Wellness Fair, and there were 350 people who passed through.
Yeah, we had so Lakewood had our annual wellness fair. Sorry, Donna, I wasn't going to put that in with the JCCOA thing, but I'm still learning. We had our annual wellness fair here at the city. We had 77 vendors show up. We had over 380 people show up for a 8:30 to noon event. And JCCOA was a part of that. So that outreach to see who's in the community, who's interested in joining. The event was a huge success. It was bigger than it has been since COVID. And we're looking to keep on growing it because it works. I don't have anything else to add. Donna, you?
Oh, I was just going to say that our next event is going to be a legislative forum in October. So we're starting to work on that. So that's where we're headed.
Okay. Thanks, Donna. Thanks, Dave. Other comments from any county, actually? No? No?
So, hi, this is Sherry Haidvogel representing Clear Creek County. I just wanted to thank Jayla for the information that she provided earlier about the meeting that we had in Idaho Springs last week, and to thank her so much for her involvement. The information that she provided was crucial and will be most beneficial in our efforts going forward.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Just a reminder.
Got this hand up, George Steele.
Thanks, guys. Mine is really brief because Allison stole all of my thunder during the public comment phase, but I appreciated her giving out such great information about our roadshow that we're going to be doing for the Older Adults Initiative this summer. Good job, Allison. That's all we got from Douglas.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, George. Anything else?
Andrea has her hand up.
If we're talking about senior resource fairs, I've attended, I believe, 4 so far. Cali. Mallee Senior Center in Englewood, Buck Recreation Center in Littleton. I attended an autism fair, which was really fascinating. And I know I attended one more that I'm just not remembering. Oh, I know, Coble Library in Centennial. They were all... Coble Library was not as well attended as I would have hoped, but the rest of them were all really well attended, and lots of great information was available to seniors. So I'm really glad I was there.
Okay, thank you. Anything else from any of the other counties?
Looks like Dawn had her hand up, and Phil.
Okay. Dawn?
Yes. Don't forget that Adams County Aging Network is having a resource fair on the 12th of June. That will be at the Thornton Connection Center, which is the old senior center in the middle of Thornton. And so if you want to attend, that's where we'll be.
Okay. Phil?
Thank you.
On a personal note, I'm an expectant great-grandparent for later this year. And on the other side, I'm president of our local Rotary Club. And just as a note for folks that service clubs in your area might be able to help out, we have 3 grantees that are in the older Coloradan range, one being Nourish, which is our Meals on Wheels, And this past Saturday, we did yard cleanup for 20 of the customers of Nourish. And that was well received. And some of them were just extremely timely relative to injuries that they had had. And so it was great to clean up those yards. Our Cycling Without Age chapter for the greater Littleton area has now grown to have 8 trishaws. And we're looking to have somewhere around 3,500 unique clients this year. So that's a little bit of our target. And I know that we've received a presentation on that before. And just wanted to mention our local income-based assisted living facility. We had a senior prom at Lily Bortz. And so that was some of the things that we're doing in conjunction with older Coloradans generally. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Phil. Do we have any other comments from anyone in the audience about anything you might
know about? A question, please, Bob. Remind me where the June meeting is going to be.
It's going to be at the Volunteers of America. We'll have information on the agenda in the agenda packet.
Is it north or south of Denver?
North.
Darn.
It's in Commerce City.
Oh, I may not be able to get there. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anything else? And then we will adjourn if there isn't anything else. So we appreciate all the presentations today, and we wish Dr. Cog much success with working with Tori. It sounds like it could be a really interesting new and very important program. So, okay. If there's nothing else, Jelly, do you have anything you want to add before we leave?
I just want to say have a wonderful Veterans Day, and stay safe and have fun.
Okay.
Memorial Day, everybody.
All right. Take care.
Thanks, everybody. Sorry. Take care. Bye.
Sorry, Memorial Day.
Yes. It's that one.
Yeah, it's that one. Sorry. It's